In 2015, Professor Mahmoud Mamdani and others, under the auspices of the African Union Commission of Inquiry, authored a report into the challenges of South Sudan.
What South Sudan needs is another transition, because there's no state in South Sudan. This was not a failed state. This was a failed transition.
The majority in the Commission of Inquiry concluded that the problem was a criminal in nature as a result of the breakdown in the law. However, Mamdani dissented and wrote a minority report titled A Separate Opinion, in which he argues that South Sudan's problem is a political problem and must be addressed as such.
Which means that you rule out of office those politically responsible for the violence. This to me includes not just Troika, but it also includes the cabinet which was in power until July 2013. That cabinet should be ruled out of office, which means the present coalition government would be ruled out of office.
A vortex of turbulence which began in December 2013 later morphed into a civil war. But a shaky power-sharing agreement created grounds for a powder keg situation, which recently prevailed in the capital when Kiir and Machar's presidential guards clashed. So who is to blame for this conflict? To answer this question, one must revisit the process leading to independence, Mamdani postulates. South Sudan's efforts to secede gained credence when in 2005 the Comprehensive Peace Agreement was signed between the Sudan People's Liberation Movement and the government of Sudan. The CPA was meant to provide a roadmap for a five-year transitional period, which would be capped with a referendum on independence of the South. All this was crowned on 9th July 2011 when the South voted overwhelmingly to secede. Yet this euphoria amongst the citizens was short-lived, as the political elite in Juba took the place of the oppressors in Khartoum.
In the history of Africa, there have been two successful secessions. One was Eritrea, the other was South Sudan. In the Eritrean case, it is because the government lost the war, and the winning party included the Eritrean Liberation Armies, and they seceded. In the South Sudan, in the Sudan case, the SPLA did not win the war. Now ask yourself a question. Why would a government agree to a referendum which is going to lead to secession?
Barely after assuming office, Kiir's regime faced internecine conflicts, widespread corruption, cronyism, and biting poverty. South Sudanese yearned for the leadership of their charismatic leader, John Garang, who had earlier on died in a helicopter crash in 2005. Professor Mamdan, who is the director of Makerere Institute for Social Research, says the decision to grant South Sudan independence was rushed by the United States, Britain, and Norway, which make up the Troika.
It is after 9/11 that the US was adamant that the negotiations move forward as quickly as possible. The government of Sudan was scared that it may be the next target of US aggression, next after Afghanistan and Iraq. It's only that fear that explains why they agreed to a referendum.
Mamdan says the Troika deal was not all-inclusive.
You know, if you compare this transition with the Lancaster House conferences that took place at the end of colonialism, say Uganda's case or Kenya or Nigeria, in all these cases, all the political parties came around a conference table, whether they had guns or not. In the South Sudanese case, the Troika brought together only those with guns.
In 2010, there was a conference which was meant to bring all political parties together. This would provide a platform for a transitional government.
Keep in mind, there was never an election in independent South Sudan. Salva Kiir has never been elected as president of South Sudan. He was elected as vice president of Sudan. So no election, nothing. And yet you move to independence, you give power to a government.
In December 2013, the country imploded when disagreements within the SPLM political bureau spilled over into an ethnic conflict, divisions which remained bubbling below the radar until they came to surface when over 272 were killed recently. It's this unstable ground that Mamdani says informs the tensions seen today. The United Nations has maintained a 7,000 troop presence in South Sudan since 9th July 2011, and yet their presence remains a point of controversy. The number grew to 12,500 after the December 2013 violence. According to the original mandate, the UN mission was only peacekeeping, which limits their role. Mamdani says the United Nations must be held accountable for failing to keep peace.
You are talking of stopping a slaughter of unarmed civilians. The UN prides itself in being the originator of a doctrine called responsibility to protect. So if they were not there to protect the civilians, what were they there for? Right. What had the UN learned from Rwanda?
Whereas Ananizi Kam has returned to Juba, the international community, in consultation with the South Sudan citizens, must find a political solution which is all-inclusive and which, according to Mamdani, excludes from government the two protagonists, Kiir and Machar.
I think politically this authority should be led by somebody who has both the experience and the vision and the confidence of everybody concerned. In my view, there is one party, which is the AU High-Level Panel on Sudan, led by former President Thabo Mbeki.
Shirandu Huchre, NTV.